You know what's more complicated than explaining Bitcoin to your grandma? Getting a Cybertruck approved for UK roads. You see, Tesla's angular beast has been turning heads and raising eyebrows. But there are five massive hurdles keeping this electric tank off British roads. And just trust me on this, number five is going to make you question everything you thought you knew about vehicle safety regulations. Hi guys, my name is Des from the Electric Oracle. I'm glad you can join us today. Today we're diving deep into something that's been causing quite a stir in the UK EV world. While Americans are already rolling around in their Cybertrucks, we Brits are left wondering if we'll ever see one legally cruising down the M1. And you know what? There's a good reason for that. In fact, there are five good reasons. Let's start with what might seem like a really minor issue. But in the world of vehicle regulations, it really isn't. You see, the Cybertruck's lighting system is about as compatible with UK regulations as a tea bag with a coffee machine. Now, you might think, come on, Des, they're lights, right? Well, if I'm honest, the Cybertruck's red indicators are a big no-no in the UK, where amber is mandatory. And this isn't just about being picky, it's about safety and driver expectations that have been ingrained for decades. Let me break down exactly why this matters. In the UK, drivers are conditioned to respond to amber indicators in a specific way. When you see the amber flash, your brain instantly processes it as a signal of intent. And red indicators like those on the Cybertruck are reserved exclusively for brake lights and rear fog lamps. Do you know what? It's kind of like showing up at a black tie event wearing a neon tracksuit. Technically, you're dressed, but you're breaking some serious protocols there. But wait, it gets more interesting. The Cybertruck's unique light bar design creates another headache. UK regulations require clear separation between different lighting functions. And the continuous LED strip at the front and rear of the Cybertruck, that's a regulatory nightmare. Each function, indicators, brake lights, position lamps, needs distinct spacing and clear boundaries. So let's look at what Yani attempted with his Cybertruck.
So the last time you guys saw my Cybertruck, it looked like this. Now, it looks like this.
You see, he tried modifying the lights, but it's not as simple as swapping out a few bulbs. You see, the entire lighting system needs to be reworked, and I mean the entire system. We're talking about completely new indicator units, redesigned light bar segmentation, modified control modules, and also updated software to handle UK-specific lighting patterns. Also, you're going to need new wiring harnesses to accommodate those changes. And here's where it gets really fascinating. The Cybertruck's lighting system is integrated into its structural design. Those sleek lines and minimal panel gaps, they are actually part of the problem. You see, modifying the lights means potentially compromising the vehicle's carefully engineered aesthetics and weatherproofing. You see, traditional cars have standardized mounting points and spaces for different market requirements. The Cybertruck, it's about as modifiable as a solid block of stainless steel, which coincidentally is exactly what it's made of. But perhaps the most ironic part is Tesla's own data shows that proper indicator systems reduce collision risks by up to 28%. Yet their flagship truck can't meet these basic safety requirements in one of Europe's largest automotive markets. Now, here's where things start getting heavier, literally. The Cybertruck weighs more than your average hopes and dreams combined. We're talking about a vehicle that tips the scales at over 3.5 tons. And in the UK, that's not just a number, it's a legal boundary that changes everything. So let's put that into perspective. The Cybertruck's weight puts it in the same category as a small commercial vehicle. That's right, in the eyes of the UK law, this passenger vehicle has more in common with a delivery truck than your neighbour's Range Rover. And that creates a fascinating domino effect of several problems. So first, let's talk about the licensing. You see, if you cross that 3.5 ton threshold, you're basically in C1 license territory. That means your standard category B license, you know, the one that lets you drive everything from a Fiat 500 to a Mercedes S-Class, suddenly isn't enough. Imagine dropping 60K on a vehicle only to realize you need to go back to driving school. Talk about a plot twist. You see, the C1 license requirement isn't just a minor inconvenience. we're talking about additional theoretical testing, practical training with commercial vehicles, medical examinations, and a certificate of professional competence considerations, regular license renewals with medical checks after the age of 45. But wait, there's even more. The weight issue cascades into other areas. You see, insurance companies treat it as if it's a commercial vehicle, and that's going to affect your premium. Parking restrictions in city centres and residential areas, and lower speed limits on certain roads, different MOT testing requirements, and restricted access to multi-storey car parks. And here's where Tesla's engineering choices really come back to haunt them in the UK. The Cybertruck's weight isn't just from hauling around a massive battery pack. Guys, that's an armour-grade stainless steel body. It's kind of like wearing a suit of medieval armour to a modern boxing match. Impressive, but maybe not the most practical choice in the world. So this is the bit I love. Let's get down to some numbers. Average electric SUV weights are between 2.2 and 2.8 tons. Take, for example, a Range Rover, one of the UK's heaviest passenger cars. That's about 2.9 tons. But the Cybertruck, that's over 3.5 tons. A typical 7.5 ton commercial vehicle obviously is 7.5 tons. So Tesla's car sits in this bizarre regulatory no man's land between passenger vehicles and commercial trucks. It's too heavy to be treated as a car, but it's not designed to meet commercial vehicle standards either. And speaking of paperwork, let's talk about the certificate of conformity, or in Cybertruck's case, the certificate of non-conformity. This document is basically a vehicle's passport for UK roads. And right now, the Cybertruck's application status is somewhere between pending and good luck with that. Now, I know what you're thinking. Surely with enough money and determination, you can get your vehicle certified, right? Now, hold your horses, because this is where things get really interesting. And by interesting, I mean bureaucratically nightmarish. Should EVs be given special weight allowances to accommodate their batteries? Or would this create an unfair double standard in vehicle safety regulations? Let me know in the comments below. You see, the certificate of conformity isn't just one test or one piece of paper. It's a comprehensive evaluation covering over 70 different vehicle systems and features, and every single one of them needs to pass. So think of it like a driving test where failing any part means failing the whole thing. Except in this case, failing means your revolutionary electric vehicle is legally equivalent to a very expensive garden ornament. So let's break down just some of what needs to be certified. You've got an electromagnetic compatibility test, brake testing performance, windscreen washer and wiper systems, door latch and hinge strength, seatbelt anchorages, interior fittings safety, external projects, external projections, and yes, those problematic lights we talked about earlier. So guys, here's the thing. The Cybertruck wasn't just designed without these UK standards in mind. It was designed in a way that actively challenges them. And that stainless steel body that we mentioned, it needs to prove it won't turn into a giant reflective safety hazard in sunlight. Those sharp edges, each one needs to meet specific radius requirements. And do you remember that weight issue we just discussed? It creates a cascade effect through the certification process. Different braking standards apply. Structural integrity tests become more stringent. Tire specifications need to meet commercial vehicle standards. Even the wing mirrors. Oh wait, the Cybertruck doesn't have traditional wing mirrors. And without this certificate, you can't register the vehicle, legally drive it on UK roads, pass standard vehicle inspections, get proper insurance coverage, or import it without special permissions. And you can't sell it as a road vehicle. So to put this into perspective, even the most challenging vehicle certifications typically take about 6 to 12 months. For the Cybertruck, industry experts are suggesting it could take years on modifications and testing, if it's even possible at all. And here's the thing, even if Tesla wanted to make all of these changes, they'd essentially need to be designing a completely different vehicle. It would be like trying to turn the Shard into a Tudor mansion while keeping it essentially the same building. Technically possible, maybe, and practically feasible, about as likely as finding a charging station when you're at 1% battery. The Cybertruck's entire safety testing regime is about as UK compatible as driving on the right side of the road. And when I say entire, I mean we're talking about fundamental safety features that most manufacturers figured out decades ago. So let's start with something that seems basic, but it is actually mind-boggling. The Cybertruck's structure itself. Most modern vehicles are designed with what we call programmed deformation, specific areas that crumple in precise ways during a collision. And here's what UK safety regulators are scratching their heads about. First, there's the infamous unbreakable windows. Sure, that might not stop a steel ball sometimes, but UK regulations require windows that can break in specific ways during emergencies. It's kind of like having a fire exit made of reinforced concrete. Impressive engineering, but the wrong application. Then we've got the visibility issues that go way beyond those missing wing mirrors. The A-pillars are thick enough to hide entire vehicles, and the high hood line creates massive front blind spots. The rear visibility is more theoretical than practical, and the camera system isn't approved as a primary visibility aid in the UK. But wait, it gets even better. Let's talk about the safety testing itself. The Euro NCAP protocols require specific impact absorption patterns, and the Cybertruck's rigid structure doesn't play nice with these tests. Side impact protection is compromised by ultra-strong doors, the roof crush resistance tests, they might actually damage the testing equipment. And here's where Tesla's innovation becomes its own worst enemy. The Cybertruck's unique materials and construction methods mean that standard safety assessment tools and procedures might not even be applicable. You see, we're talking about new testing protocols needed for the stainless steel body, unknown behavior in multi-vehicle collisions, and unconventional energy absorption in patterns, untested emergency response scenarios. And speaking of emergency response, let's talk about what happens after a crash. You see, traditional vehicles have clearly marked cut points for emergency services. And the Cybertruck, it's like giving firefighters a can opener and asking them to open a bank vault. The ultra-hard stainless steel body that makes it safe could actually trap occupants in an emergency. And here are some real numbers that keep the safety experts up at night. Standard vehicle body panels are 0.7 to 1 millimeters thick, and the Cybertruck stainless steel is 3 millimeters thick. Standard jaws of life-cutting force, 75 to 100 kN. Force needed for the Cybertruck? To be honest, guys, we actually don't know yet. And let's not forget about the battery safety. While Tesla has a good track record with battery protection, the Cybertruck's unique structure means traditional fire suppression techniques might need to be completely rethought. It's kind of like bringing a water pistol to fight a very specific type of electric fire. So let me ask you a question. Should emergency services be required to upgrade their equipment for new vehicle technologies, or should manufacturers be required to design vehicles that work with existing emergency protocols? Let me know in the comments below. The really fascinating part is most of these issues wouldn't be deal breakers individually, but together, they create a perfect storm of safety compliance challenges that make the previous issues we discussed look like minor speed bumps. And now we arrive at the biggest issue of all, pedestrian safety. You see, those sharp angles might look cool in the cyberpunk of 2077, but in reality, they're about as pedestrian friendly as a medieval knight's armor. And unlike the previous issues, this one quite literally means life or death. So let me paint you a picture. You see, modern cars are designed with something called pedestrian protection systems. You see, the front end of most vehicles is essentially a carefully engineered crumple zone for human bodies. Yeah, do you know what? I know it sounds quite morbid, doesn't it? But there's brilliant engineering behind it. You've got soft, deformable bumpers that absorb impact, hood designs that provide cushioning space, specially designed wiper mechanisms that break away on impact, sloped fronts that reduce the severity of impacts. But the Cybertruck, it's basically the automotive equivalent of running into a stainless steel wall. So let's break down the specific issues. First, those iconic angles. You see, UK regulations require a minimum radius of 3.2 millimeters on external edges. And the Cybertruck's edges, they're actually sharper than some kitchen knives. In a collision, these edges don't just impact, they concentrate force into really narrow points. Is basic physics turned deadly? Here are some sobering numbers. Impact force on a traditional car's hood is distributed over 400 to 600 millimeters. Impact force on the Cybertruck angles is concentrated on points as small as 5 millimeters. Pedestrian survival rate at 40 miles per hour with a modern car is about 60%. Predicted survival rate with rigid angular structures is significantly lower, unfortunately. But it actually gets worse. Remember the unbreakable stainless steel body we've been talking about? In pedestrian impacts, you actually want certain parts to deform. But the Cybertruck's ultra-rigid structure means all the impact force gets transferred directly to the pedestrian instead of being absorbed by the vehicle. So let's look at specific design elements that make regulators really pull their hair out. The sharp-edged front end that acts like a wedge. The flat vertical windscreen that offers no impact absorption. And the rigid side panels that don't deform on impact. Also, the high flat hood that increases head injury risk. And the exposed wheel arches with really sharp edges. And here's where Tesla's innovation actually works against them. That stainless steel exoskeleton is not just strong, it's actively resistant to the kind of deformation that could actually save lives. It's like they've built the perfect vehicle for surviving a zombie apocalypse, but forgot that we still need to protect regular humans in the meantime. And the real kicker, modern pedestrian safety systems are incredibly sophisticated. You've got active hood systems that raise on impact, external airbags in critical impact zones, breakaway panels that absorb energy, specialist materials that deform in specific ways. Unfortunately, the Cybertruck has none of these. Instead, it has what safety experts are calling a geometrically aggressive design. That's engineering speak for everything about this shape is dangerous for pedestrians. And unlike our previous issues, this isn't something you can fix with a software update or a light modification. We're talking about a fundamental design change that would essentially require rebuilding the entire vehicle from the ground up. It's like trying to turn a tank into a pillow. The very features that make it distinctive are the ones that make it dangerous. So what does this mean for the future of the Cybertruck in the UK? You see, while some brave souls like Yani are trying to modify their way to compliance, the road ahead is rockier than the Cybertruck's off-road capabilities. The real question isn't whether these changes can be fixed, it's whether Tesla will ever see enough potential in the UK market to justify the massive redesign needed to make it happen. What do you think? Should Tesla make the necessary changes to bring the Cybertruck to the UK roads, or should they just focus on the markets where their current design is already approved? Let me know in the comments below. And speaking of UK challenges, you won't want to miss our next video where we're diving into something equally shocking. It's the truth about Britain's charging infrastructure. Did you know that the UK is adding a new charger every 25 minutes? Sounds great, right? Well, wait until you see where they're going. Hit that subscribe button and the notification bell to learn why 44% of chargers are concentrated in just two regions. And what this means for Britain's electric future. Guys, my name is Des from the Electric Oracle. Until next time, keep charging forward.